Okay. Well, good morning, everyone. So good to see you here today. So good to be in God's house here this morning. Looking forward to what God is going to do in each of our lives, in the life of each family here today, and in the life of our church family as well. Looking forward to it. Looking forward to worshiping with you here today. And we're going to do that together by starting out with number 11 in your hymn books. All creatures of our God and King, number 11. Stand, if you would, please, as we worship our Heavenly Father together here this morning. Number 11, all creatures of our God and King. Lord, for this day you have blessed us with, this place where we can gather here together this morning. Father, the fact that we can lift our voices to worship you, to praise you. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings in our lives. And I thank you for each and every one here this morning. I pray that your Holy Spirit would just do a tremendous work here today. Speak to our hearts. Father, I pray that we would each have ears to hear your voice, and we would be obedient to your will here this morning, whatever that may be in the life of each person here. And so, Lord, we just thank you again for this time. We thank you and praise you here this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. You know, I want to welcome everybody who is here with us this morning, and of course all those who are watching from home on our live stream. Glad you're faithful to worship God here this morning today, and just praise you for that. Thank you for that. We're going to continue worshiping together with number 252 there in your hymn books. 252 with the song Down at the Cross. So sing out this morning as we praise God together. 252 Down at the Cross.
Down at the cross where my Savior died. Now we're forgiving for sin I cried.
Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. That's Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 7. You know, when we think about the story of the cross, we think about Jesus going to the cross, dying there on the cross, them taking him down and placing him in that tomb. But then 3 days later, the glorious resurrection. Jesus rose again and walked out of that tomb and is alive not only then, but he is alive today, sitting at the right hand of the Father, just as y'all are sitting in those pews here this morning. He is risen. He is alive. Glory to his name. Next song we're going to sing is about that very fact. It's called The Risen Christ, and it's number 268 in your hymn books. To know him as your Lord and Savior here this morning. And if you are saved, if you are born again, that you would strive to come to know him more and more each and every day of your life. We're going to continue worshiping at this time by bringing up of our offering, and that is an act of worship. And so I would ask that you would pray over your offering as the music plays, and then bring it forward, present it to God as an act of worship by placing it in the plates here up front. And so let's continue to worship as we bring up our offering, say a word of prayer, and then worship the Lord by presenting it to him as the music plays. Thank you. victory in Jesus. Well, I like that version. It'll get you a little toe tapping, makes you feel kind of good. You know what I mean? Praise the Lord. We're going to continue worshiping as we sing our last song here this morning. And that is going to be number 133. Shout to the Lord. 133. And do that very thing. Lift up your voices to Almighty God, who is worthy of the very best praise that we can give Him here this morning. 133, shout to the Lord. A few days ago, I officiated a funeral, And the main scripture verse that I used for that service was James chapter 1, verse 17. And that verse reads this. It says, "Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning." You know, this verse worked perfectly for a funeral service as the family reflected upon their loved one's life, the many blessings that they received, and all the good and perfect gifts that were given from God Almighty. This morning, we will be having a baby dedication. And as I was praying and planning for this, that verse from James just kept coming back to my mind over and over and over again. And it just goes to show you how incredible God's Word truly is. The exact same verse that can be used as someone's time on this earth is over is also very fitting as someone's life is just starting out. The birth of a child is most certainly a good and perfect gift given to a couple from Almighty God Himself. A little baby is a miracle. It is a blessing. It is a cause for thanksgiving and celebration. Today, Chris and Jessica would like to dedicate their second daughter, Emma, to the Lord. And we all have the honor and privilege to share in this joyous occasion with them. So Chris, Jessica, why don't you bring Trinity and Emma on up here if you would, please. You know, God has established the home as one of the most vital institutions on earth. God said to Adam and Eve, "Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth." Since that time, God has blessed man and woman with the wonder of birth. The birth of Emma has been a great blessing to this family and to many others. We can take our rule of faith and practice for this service today from God's Word. We find several accounts in the Bible of children being dedicated to God. In the Old Testament, Samuel was dedicated to God in 1 Samuel chapter number 1. In the New Testament, Jesus Himself was dedicated to God in Luke chapter number 2. So we come today not only to ask God's special blessing on this life, but also to challenge and encourage Chris and Jessica to be a godly father and a godly mother who will love and care for Emma, to work hard to give her every opportunity to live in the kind of life and the kind of home that God wants her to live. So in this act of dedication, I will ask this young couple three questions. Do you, Chris and Jessica, present and dedicate Emma to God? If so, say we do. Do you stand before us and before God Almighty today seeking to be godly parents? If so, say we do. Do you commit before God and these witnesses that you will do all that is within your power to maintain your home where Emma will be cared for and loved? And do you commit to rearing this child to love and honor God with all of her heart? If so, say we do. Yes, God has given us the family home, father, mother, children. The home was the first institution brought into existence. Now, the church has been given by Jesus Christ Himself. And these two have been brought together to faithfully train and encourage the home and the church. The church stands nearby to assist the family in every way we can, to properly teach this child to live life to the fullest. It is God's plan that the home and church unite forces to train this child to share the love of Christ along with the gospel message to her, to pray for and to encourage her, to wait for the day when she will personally accept Jesus Christ as her Lord and her Savior, to witness her baptism, to disciple her and to train her to follow Jesus. Church, we have heard Chris and Jessica state their commitment to a greater level of Christ-likeness for the sake of Emma. Now, church, will you now indicate your willingness to do your part and help them keep their promise? If so, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. So may this day be remembered fondly as your family continues to faithfully follow the Lord. Let's all bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before you, knowing how great and good you are. We thank you, Lord, for the many blessings you pour out upon each of our lives, each and every day. Those good and perfect gifts that come from you. We thank you for that so very much. And Father, we thank you for the gift of life. Lord, I thank you for little Emma. Lord, the little one she is now, and Lord, we look forward to who she will grow into in the future. We thank you for Trinity. We thank you for Chris and Jessica. Bless their family, Lord, as they continue to do their very best to faithfully follow you, Lord, to live in such a way that is pleasing and glorifying to you. We thank you for them. Father, continue to guide and direct our church as we assist them the very best we can to teach little Emma to grow and love you as her Heavenly Father. Father, help us to just continue to be faithful to follow you and spread the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we do again thank you for all the good and perfect gifts you bestow upon us. We pray all this in Jesus' name, and all God's people say it. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. It's been a good day so far, you know? It's been a great day so far. Now we get to get into God's Word and see what He's got in store for each of us here today. So if you got your Bibles with you, I would ask that you would turn to Matthew chapter number 14, if you would please. Matthew chapter 14. Boy, we've got to praise God, we've got to worship Him, we've got to be a part of a baby dedication, and now we get into God's Word. Man, I've been so excited for this morning, I really have. So very excited for it. A couple things I want to bring to your attention before we get into the message here today. If you happen to notice something different when you walked in this morning, that side door over there, construction has begun on our new sound room. That's what we're going to relocate all of our sound equipment to create some more room for what we have and to also expand in the near future with some plans that we have moving forward. But you'll see the construction has begun on that. It'll probably take a few weeks to complete. But if you were wondering, if you hadn't already heard, that's what's taking place back in the corner there. You'll see it. If you didn't notice, check it out on the way out. You'll see the progress over the next few weeks. And I just thank and praise God that He is allowing us to continue to make improvements and upgrades here within our church facilities. That's just going to be a blessing to our church family and all those who come in to visit and all those who will be watching online. And we're trying to strive to improve that as well. And so check all that out. Pay attention over the next few weeks and just thank and praise God for His blessings that we're able to do that. Also, today is our Youth Sunday. We have a little statue out there over there to remind us to be thankful for the young people of our church, to pray for the young people of our church. We do that on the third Sunday of every month. And so, again, thank and praise God for those young people of our church. Strive to do to set a good example for the young people of our church, to do your very best to train them up. And they are a blessing. They are an absolute blessing. And God's been so very good to us with the number of young people that we have in our church. And so pray for them faithfully. Give to them however you can. Serve them in any way you can. Set a godly example for them as well. And so remember the young people of our church in your prayers, if you would, please. You're there in Matthew chapter number 14. And today we will be looking at one of the better known events in the life of Jesus. We're going to be taking a look at the time when he walked on water. We're going to start in verse number 22. We're going to read down through verse number 27 here this morning. And so let's just jump into God's Word here in Matthew chapter 14, starting with verse number 22. And again, reading down through verse number 27. So Matthew 14, 22. And straightway, Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. Now, this is right after the feeding of the 5,000. If you're not familiar with that event, I would encourage you to go back and read those verses just prior to what we're reading right now. And so there's been a big event that took place, some big happenings there. And so all that has concluded. Jesus tells the disciples, get yourselves into a boat. I'll meet you over on the other side. He sends the multitudes away here in verse number 22. Now let's look at verse number 23. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And so Jesus gets off by himself a little bit to pray, to spend some time in prayer with the Heavenly Father, kind of recharges batteries a bit, which we all should do from time to time. And so he went into a mountain apart to pray, and when the evening was come, he was there alone. Verse 24, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. The disciples are in that ship. They find themselves in the middle of the sea, and they're in a very strong storm. Verse 25, and in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. Fourth watch of night, this is late, sometime between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. I mean, it's in the wee hours of the morning, it is late. And they're in that ship in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the sea, and Jesus makes his way to them, walking on the water. Verse number 26. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, is it a spirit? And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer here as we begin. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for what has taken place in your house so far this morning. What a privilege and honor it's been to be here. We thank you, Lord, that we can open up your word at this time and listen to the preaching of it, and just allow your Holy Spirit to speak to us. And I pray that you would do that very thing. I pray that you would speak to each heart here today, each person here today. I pray that everyone would have ears to hear your still small voice speaking to them. And I pray that we would not be hearers only, but Father, we would respond to your voice, to your will in our lives, and we would be doers of your will in our, for each one's lives. Father, be with me. Give me the words to speak, the way in which to speak them. Father, may born-again believers be challenged and strengthened in their faith today, encouraged and uplifted. And if there is one here, one watching from home, one listening, who has never been saved, never been born again, they do not know your Son, Jesus Christ, as their Lord and their Savior, and they do not know heaven as their eternal home. Father, I pray that through the preaching of your word, the conviction of your Holy Spirit, that today would be their day of salvation. And so, Father, just continue to be with us, speak to us, guide and direct us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Of all the events in the life of Jesus that the scriptures record, him walking on the water is a pretty well-known event. Even among those who don't go to church, even those among those who don't know Jesus as their Savior, many know or have heard about him walking on the water. You ever tried to walk on water? Anybody here ever tried to walk? I have. I got to admit it. I've tried standing on the edge of a pool, trying to step out on it. Listen, it's never panned out for me personally, but I've tried it. That has nothing to do with the sermon. But anyways, Jesus walked on the water. Jesus did that, and we're going to look at that event here this morning, and we're going to look at three different aspects of this event where Jesus walked on the water, and we're going to look at three different aspects of this here in Matthew chapter number 14. If you're a note taker, jot these down. We're going to look at number one, we're going to look at the storm. Number two, we're going to look at how the disciples handled the storm. And then the last thing we'll look at here this morning is how Jesus handled the disciples. And so we're going to look at the storm, we're going to look at how the disciples handled the storm, and we're going to look at how Jesus handled the disciples. We'll look at these three different points, these three different aspects of this event, and hopefully each of us will learn a little something from each one of them. So let's dive in and look at number one, the storm. You got your Bibles open. Let's look at these verses again. We'll just start with verse number 22. Read down through them. Verse 22, straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. Now let we get to verse number 24, and let's zero in on that one for a minute. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. The disciples who are in this boat find themselves in a storm. I don't know about you, but I love a good storm. I love storms. I love in the springtime or the summertime, I love to watch a thunderstorm roll through. You see that front come in. A lot of times you can see the storm coming. And I'll sit out on the back porch next door here, and I'll just set me up a lawn chair and watch it roll in. You know, those hot summer afternoons, and you feel that cold breeze of that front hit you. The wind start, pushing the trees over, and the rain comes. And I'll sit out there until I can't any longer with the rain or whatever hitting me. But I love a good thunderstorm in the summertime. I love a good snowstorm in the wintertime, and we've had plenty of those of late. Lots of snow to watch falling down of late. Big old pile of snow over here in the parking lot. I don't know if you noticed. I have nicknamed it Mount Everest because we have got so much snow piled up over there from this winter. It'll take probably midsummer before that all melts away, you know. But anyways, I love a good storm. I love a thunderstorm. I love a good snowstorm. I just enjoy those things. I love watching those things. But here in our account this morning, the disciples were not loving the storm so much. They were not loving this storm that they found themselves in the middle of. And they were in the midst of it. They were in the thick of it. Right here in the middle of this storm. Keep in mind, it's the middle of the night. It's the fourth watch. It's late. It's the middle of the night. They're on this little boat. The wind is blowing. The waves are crashing all around them. And in Mark's account, Mark chapter 6, it says that the disciples were toiling in rowing. And so they were fighting against this storm. They were fighting to keep control. They were toiling and working hard, rowing to try to keep control of this boat. Listen, they were fighting for their lives in the midst of this storm. The disciples were experiencing that. And this is probably not news to anybody here, but I'll share it with you anyways. We all experience storms, don't we? We all experience storms. We've made it through many snowstorms so far in the last month or so. We have survived many thunderstorms in the spring and the summer over the years. But our verses today, these verses speak of more than those kind of storms. those storm fronts that move through, those physical storms. And speaking of much more than that, these verses teach us and are speaking about the storms of life. The storms of life. And we all have them. We all go through them. Some may be going through them right now. Some may be in the midst of one right now. I'm talking about the storms of life, the hard times, the trials, the tribulations, those painful events that we all must endure. Each and every one of us will face difficulties as we journey through our lives, storms that we will experience. Listen to these words in John chapter 16, verse 33. The words of Jesus himself. He says, "These things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace." He goes on to say this, "In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." Catch that middle part. He says, "In the world ye," that word "ye" means you. That's the big translation of that word "ye." That's you. "In the world ye shall have tribulation." He doesn't say you might. He says you will. You will go through tough times. You will go through trials. You will face storms. You will go through this. We all do. Every single one of us. We all go through storms in life. Everyone here. Do not think that it's just you. Because everybody experiences the storms. And if we're honest with ourselves and with God, sometimes we don't think that's quite fair. We say to ourselves, I've been trying to do my very best. I've been trying to be a good person. I've been going to church every Sunday. I made it for a month straight. I've been going to church every Sunday. I've been reading my Bible almost every day. I've been praying like I should. Why is this storm raging in my life? Because I have been doing everything right. Why is this storm raging against me? See, the truth is, and you have got to realize this, we all must realize this, that even the most faithful followers of Jesus go through storms. Were the disciples faithful in our verses today? Were the disciples faithful in this event that we've read about today? Were they faithful? Yes, they were. They were obedient. They were doing what Jesus told them to do. Look again at verse 22. It says, "And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him into the other side." He says to the disciples, "Get in a ship and go to the other side." And they did exactly what Jesus told them to do. They did exactly what they were right where the Lord wanted them to be, doing exactly what the Lord wanted them to be doing. And the storm came anyway. We all face difficulties. We all go through storms of life. David faced a giant. That was his storm at the time. Moses had trouble with his speech. God says, "Go back into Egypt, talk to Pharaoh." And Moses is like, "I got trouble with my..." That was a storm that he was facing at that time. Daniel faced some lions. Paul had some sort of physical challenge, that thorn in the flesh that he talks about. My big toe hurts today. It does. True story. My big toe hurts today. We're all dealing with something. Now, I understand a sore big toe is not that big of a storm, but I'm dealing with it. We all face challenges. We all go through difficulties. Every single one of us. You will face problems in life, some bigger, some smaller, but you'll face them. We all do. The disciples did here in these verses. The storm. So we've looked at number one. We've looked at the storm. That's number one. Now let's move on to the second point, the second aspect of the story. Number two, how the disciples handled the storm. So let's look at that. Let's look at how the disciples handled this storm that they found themselves in. although they were being faithful to God, although they were right where He wanted them to be, they are in this storm. And so let's look at how they handled it. We see in verse number 24 that they were in the midst of it. I mean, they were smack in the middle of the storm. It was raging all around them. We know that they were in the middle of it. We know, according to Mark chapter 6, that they were fighting the storm. They were struggling. They were fighting against it. They were giving it their all. We know, according to verse number 25, that it is the middle of the night. It's the fourth watch of night. And we know, according to that same verse, verse 25, that Jesus is walking to them on the water. We know that. Now look at verse number 26. It says, "And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, 'It is a spirit.' And they cried out for fear." This is how the disciples handled this storm. The disciples saw him walking on the sea. They were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. Get this. The disciples, they are there in the boat. They are there in the midst of the storm. They saw Jesus. They see him. We see that in verse 26. They saw Jesus, but they did not know it was him. Why? They were too caught up in the storm. They were distracted by the storm. They didn't recognize Jesus because of the storm. They could not see Jesus, although he was right there in front of them, because of the storm. They saw Jesus, but they didn't know him. It says the disciples saw him walking on the sea. What does this verse say next? It says they were troubled. So they saw Jesus, but they didn't recognize him because of the storm. They were troubled. They were stressed out. They were worried. We see that in verse 26. They were not thinking straight because of the storm. They saw Jesus, they didn't recognize him. They were troubled and stressed out, and they were not thinking straight. Look at the verse. They see Jesus walking on the sea. They were troubled, saying, look at this part of the verse. They were saying, when they see him, they didn't recognize him. They're troubled, and they say, "It is a spirit." They think it's a ghost. They think it is a ghost walking towards them. Listen, they were not thinking straight. If they're there in the boat, storm is raging, they're distracted by the storm, they don't recognize Jesus, they're so stressed out and troubled, they see this figure, the only logical explanation that comes to their mind is, well, that must be a ghost. They were not thinking straight because of the storm. And then what's the last part of the verse say? And they cried out for fear. They were full of fear because of the storm. They were frightened because of the storm. They were scared because of the storm. You see, the problem wasn't the storm itself. The problem was how the disciples handled the storm. The problem isn't what you're going through. The problem is how you're handling it. Romans chapter 12, verse number 12. Scripture tells us that we should be rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. The disciples were not rejoicing in hope in the midst of the storm. They were not rejoicing in hope. They were not joyful at all because they had lost sight of hope. And why did they do that? Because they had lost sight of Jesus. They did not recognize him, although he was right there in front of him. The disciples were not rejoicing in hope. The disciples were not patient in tribulation. They were troubled. They were worried. They were stressed out to the max. They were running around like chickens with their heads cut off, toiling and rowing against the storm. They were not patient in tribulation. The disciples were not continuing instant in prayer. As a matter of fact, they did not cry out to the Lord at all. What's the end of verse 26 say? They cried out in fear. The problem is not the storms that we face. It's how we handle those storms. Honestly, the disciples should have known better at this point. See, this is Matthew chapter 14. If you go back to Matthew chapter 8, if you go back there and you read of the account that happened back there, the disciples were in a boat. They were in the middle of another storm back then. They were all freaking out, thinking they were going to die, thinking it was all over. Jesus is sleeping, taking a nap in the boat with them. And what does he do? What does Jesus do when they're stressed out, when they have lost sight, when they're consumed and distracted by the storm, when they're not handling it well? What does Jesus do? Calm the storm. You see, the disciples forgot about that here in chapter 14. They forgot about what Jesus had done for them in another storm. They'd lost sight of it. They lost sight of what the Lord had done and what the Lord was still capable of doing for them. The disciples were not handling the storm well at all here in chapter 14. Storms will come into your life. You got to handle your storms, and you got to handle them well. You got to stay focused on Jesus. You got to stay faithful to Jesus. You got to trust Jesus even when the storm is raging. And whatever that storm is in your life personally, you've got to handle your storms well. So we've looked at number one, the storm. We've looked at number two, how the disciples handled the storm. And now let's look at our third and final point here this morning. Let's look at number three, how Jesus handled the disciples. Verse number 27. What a great verse. But straightway Jesus spake unto them. Those disciples who are running around, scared to death, stressed out, worried, lacking focus, all those things. Straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. Man, what a verse. What a verse. As Jesus walks towards the disciples, walking on that water in the midst of the storm, keep in mind, he is walking on the water while the storm is still raging. He walks towards the disciples. He sees them on the boat acting a fool. And he says to them, be of good cheer. Calm down. Relax. Take a deep breath. Be of good cheer. He goes on to say this, it is I. I'm right here with you. It's not a ghost. It's not a spirit. It's not anything. It is I. I'm right here with you. And then he concludes by saying, be not afraid. Don't be scared. I'm right here with you. I got you. I got you. Don't worry about it. Jesus said that to the disciples, and he says that to you today, no matter what storm you are going through right now, or no matter what storm you will face tomorrow or next week or next month or next year. He says the same thing. He said this in John chapter 14, verse number 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Do you know that peace today? Do you know His peace today in your life? Do you know Him as your Lord and Savior? do you need to get back to Him today? The storms. How we handle the storms. And how the Lord responds to us. You've got to handle your storms. And you've got to handle them well. You've got to trust Jesus. You've got to grab a hold and live out these truths of Scripture. Psalm 91, verses 1 and 2. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. We got to say that no matter what's going on in our lives, no matter what storm is raging, no matter what is happening, we got to cling to that truth and live it out each and every day. Psalm 57, verse 1, Be merciful unto me, O God. Be merciful unto me, for my soul trusteth in Thee, even in the midst of a storm. Yea, in the shadow of Thy wings will I take my refuge until these calamities be overpassed. He'll see you through the storm. Psalm 46, verse number 1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble, in the storm. Realize this morning that Jesus is bigger than your storm. Whatever that may be, He's bigger than that storm. He is bigger than that storm. Realize and cling to this truth that He can calm your storm or He can calm you through it. Handle your storm. Handle it well. And give all glory to Almighty God. If you're going through a storm right now, handle it well. If you're not, you will. Handle it well. Trust Jesus. Don't lose sight of Him. Don't lose sight of the Lord. Put your faith and trust in Him and just keep your eyes on the Lord. He'll get you through the storm. Every head bowed, every eye closed here this morning.